Now Probert got the right hand free.
He's loose with the right hand, and he starts to retaliate, and down goes Nylon, and the two of them are hammering each other.
Knights of Columbus, that hurt!
It's old time hockey, the way you're supposed to play. You throw a little lumber if a guy gets in your way. You play like Gordie Howe or Eddie fucking Shore. We can't all be Gretzky's, the Muse or Bobby Orr's. Hey.
The enforcer of all hockey podcasts. It's the Biscuit. It's the Biscuit.
Damn it! Is that goal regulation size or what?
The enforcer of all hockey podcasts.
God help the fucking day if fighting's ever banned. There's a country we'll stop working on so bad this fucking can.
Hi, everybody. It's the Biscuit Podcast.
Hey, wanna go? Yeah, okay. Good luck, man. Good luck to you too, buddy.
All right, Biscuit Babies, today is a special episode, it's a retirement episode. I've done a few, I've only done one banner special, and that's the infamous Lindros special. So this will be my first retirement one. Oh, no, I did one for Yager, too. But this is a special episode for me and for my guest, a guy who, you know, essentially made Columbus hockey stay alive and made it relevant. Mr. Rick Nash, and to help me with the episode today is Shane Guilfoyle. Shane, do you happen to wear t-shirts?
I've heard of these things, but I'm really only starting to get into them, and let me tell you, what a ride it's been.
Now, see, that's what I was thinking. I used to just not wear them, and then I heard of Hairless Ape Inc., and I was like, oh, dude, this looks cool. Hairless Ape Conspiracies, and I was like, ooh, these are nice. This feels good. It almost feels better than not wearing anything at all. Another question, do you love terrorism?
I am decidedly anti-terrorism.
Good. I'm glad to hear that. Well, these guys at Hairless Ape are actually veteran-owned, veteran-operated, and also don't like terrorism. How do you feel about getting money off purchases you make on the internet?
I love discounts.
How do you like 10% off at checkout when you use the promo code TheBiscuit at Hairless Ape Inc.? How do you feel about that?
Well, my clothes are already 10% off, so let's rock and roll.
Hell yeah, man. Hell yeah. And, rolling with the veteran theme, we're also brought to you by ParkersPlatoon.org. You've heard of the Stanley Cup. Actually, you're probably a pretty big fan of Mr. Scott Parker, being an Avs fan.
I am, as an Avs fan. He was with Colorado when they lifted it in 2001. So, yeah, I don't know him personally, but I love his work on and off the ice.
Yes, exactly. And, him and his family now have the nonprofit organization to help one veteran at a time. And everyone should go check out their website and see how you can help today. That's ParkersPlatoon.org. And not always, but as of late, we are presented by HockeyFights.com. That's HockeyFights.com, where you go to watch hockey fights. And I'm sure you've been on there a time or two, my man.
I have, yeah. And I don't know if I've said this via text or not, but what an accomplishment and a huge congratulations to you for roping that in, man. That's really great that you guys were able to work together, because that's what they're all about. That's what you're all about, and it makes sense that your show and their product goes together. So,
well, thanks, man. I appreciate that. Yeah, I was very excited that the Biscuit and Fourth Line Voice are given the opportunity to reach some more ears, man. It's really a good opportunity for the show, and you know, without you, this show wouldn't happen. So, I thank you, my man.
Absolutely.
Well, we are here to talk about a man. A man you know very well, a man I know very well, by the name of Rick Nash. You remember what it was like those first couple years in Columbus before he came over, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, I do. I remember when, you know, the inaugural season when the Jackets set some expansion records, which of course have now been shattered by the Golden Knights. And I remember the season after that when they were just awful, and then him coming in as an 18-year-old, and really really putting Columbus hockey on the map and really kind of fighting for the franchise and just being a world-class athlete on the ice and a great, a really great person off the ice too. I don't know how many people know about his personal life. And I'm no expert, but I mean, he did a ton for the Columbus community and he was a really, really great ambassador for the game, for the city, for everything.
If you think about, you know, you'll see, you know, kids like now being like, oh, this is the first time a dude from Ohio has played in the NHL or things like that. You ask them, you know, what got them into it. Most of the answers are going to be Rick Nash from those early 2000s up to, you know, 2010 when he was in Columbus. He really was the role model for anybody playing hockey in especially Central Ohio, but Ohio as well.
Oh, 100%. I mean, the you know, like kids who are in the NHL now, they were born in 2000.
Right.
You know, the youngest of the crop. So they would have seen him from when he got here up to when they were 12 years old about before, you know, he got traded to New York. And, you know, I know Josh Anderson is not from here, but Rick Nash was his favorite player growing up. He wanted to be like him. And, you know, we've got Jack Roslovic playing for the Winnipeg Jets, who grew up in Columbus. And, like you said, it's immeasurable the amount of good that he has done for hockey here. I mean, he used to go to games, right? And you'd see nothing but 61 sweaters.
Oh, I mean, still see it now, dude.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I mean, now granted he was the best player, but I mean, it was like 61 and, you know, maybe a Fedorov jersey somewhere in there. It was
God, dude, I wish.
That's like all there was. And yeah, I mean, now they're still around and, it's wonderful to see that, that he's had such a lasting impact.
You know, I forgot that when he was drafted first overall in, what was it, 02, that that he was 18.
Yeah.
So I didn't, yep. I totally forgot that because he played his, you know, after he was drafted, and to be 18 and be successful as he was that first year, you know, getting 39 points as a rookie for Columbus, it really set the tone for how he was going to play the rest of his career in Columbus.
Yeah, I set the tone and the expectations. And then you think, so he's 18. He's in the best hockey league in the world. He gets 39 points, and he's on a god-awful team.
Oh, my God, dude, it was abysmal.
I mean, imagine how much better he would have done if he had been on a good team, or if he had been with the Jackets, but they were just a better team. I mean, the stuff he was able to accomplish while being on nothing but bad teams is really pretty incredible. I mean, he was on one playoff team before he went to New York.
And that would have been when the first year Columbus made it. What was that? 09?
Yeah, 809.
And that's, you know, we'd be remiss if we didn't bring that up because, you know, as much as it's not his fault that he was drafted to Columbus, because, I mean, you'd be a damn fool not to take him at that first pick. You know, those first three picks are pretty much everybody knows where it's going, especially now. And there was no mystery that he was going to go first then. And they really, he didn't have any help. I mean, he just really didn't. And it's, like you said, if he could have been and another team, it's hypothetical, but who knows what he might have been able to do, especially for a dude that was, you know, 6'4", 220 pounds, moving the way he did and scoring the way he did. It was really, you know, for me as a kid, you know, 02, I was, a freshman, right? In 02, something like that. Is that right? Yeah. So it was like, I mean, I was able to, like, really watch hockey and know – like what was going on. I was able to actually appreciate the game more. It wasn't just like, oh, fucking Gretzky, you know, this is cool. It was actually becoming like the fan that I am now. It really was watching Rick Nash play.
Yeah, and I think he did that for a lot of people, you know. I mean, if you were in Central Ohio or anywhere in Ohio for that matter, prior to the Blue Jackets, you were pretty much without fail a Blackhawks, Red Wings, or Penguins fan.
Yeah, I say that all the time, and I was a Maple Leaf fan, and that's only because of Wayne Gretzky 3D hockey. Doug Gilmore was so goddamn good on there. it was like that. This is it.
Yeah, being from Colorado, I was an Avalanche fan, but I remember getting for my birthday, because my parents were divorced, so I would come into town for vacation and stuff and summer break from school and Christmas and all that. And before the Jackets got here for Christmas, I don't know. Anyway, for some gift sometime, somebody got me a Penguins t-shirt and it was, of course, because that's what was around here. And then the first year they were in town, the Jackets, my parents finally got me my first Blue Jackets t-shirt. Had the big ass stinger on the front and the goofy banner underneath it that said Blue Jackets and stuff. But it was like, once that finally got here and then Nash finally got here, it really really took hold.
He was fun to watch, man. I mean, on a team where you have, Sanderson and Wright and, like Whitney, guys like that, he really was a shining spot. And, quickly made it up the ranks there and got an A, a few years after being in there. Do you recall who won the Calder in 02? I know that's throw it at you, but, he had a hell of a rookie year.
Yeah, off the top of my head, I should know this, but
I can't think of it.
Yeah, I can't think. I can look, but off the top of my head, I don't remember. But yeah, he had a hell of a run out of it. That's for sure.
He really did, and we talked about the teams and how just bad they were. I mean, they only won 40 games once when he was there, and that was that playoff year. And, the right. rest of them are like 28 wins, 22 wins, 29 wins, 25, like just barely scratching by to keep people in the seats.
It was Danny Heatley of the Atlanta Thrashers.
Holy shit.
I haven't heard that name in a while.
No, I haven't either. Damn, I would have. That's why I don't know that.
Yeah. Wonder what that dude's up to. Anyway. But yeah, just awful, awful teams.
Yeah, it pains me to say it. I mean, I still watch, but it was like you weren't expecting to win, and it sucked.
Oh yeah, I mean, as a Jackets fan, oh man, I don't even know if I could pinpoint the time when I started to expect this team to win, but it wasn't for a long time.
Dude, it wasn't until John Tortorella came. I mean, it really wasn't. It was like, okay, now we're going to start winning. Here we go. And now people are getting pissed when they lose. It wasn't ever like that. That was the more expected. It's really been a crazy turnaround.
It was almost like, we'll probably lose. Maybe we'll get a nice surprise and we'll win sort of thing and see a good game. But yeah, you're right, man. It wasn't until that second, third playoff appearance where it was like, all right, now it's time to,
yeah,
which absolutely. Is so sad.
It is, man. And, so he, he plays, he does very well for himself, that second year in getting 57 points. And then, what happens in 04. 05, they come back and he gets the A slapped on him and, plays like an assistant captain. You know, 54 points, then 57, and then 69. He's really getting heated up in 08. I mean, he's really turning it on and, you know, getting ready to play his best hockey. And hadn't really, in my memory, you know, had these concussion problems yet, where that ultimately ended his career.
And then, yeah, it seems like he didn't really have those concussion problems, and maybe I'm just not remembering correctly because I got my own freaking stupid brain problems, but I feel like it wasn't really an issue until he got to New York.
That's what I'm trying to remember, and it's because he played, I mean, a lot of games, but I don't remember him sitting out for concussions, and I know guys were kind of not – they weren't being told to sit out back then, and it was different even, you know, in the mid-2000s. But like I said, and, you know, you agree here that I don't remember it being a thing until he went to New York, and it was like, oh, shit's starting to happen to him now.
Yeah, and it was just kind of like – almost like a Sidney Crosby thing where he got one, and then he got another one. And we're like, man, this poor guy, like, when's he gonna catch a break?
Now, is that like a scientific fact? Like, once you've had one, you're more susceptible to have more, right?
Yes.
Okay, yeah. I thought so. And, you know, he ends up wearing the C, you know, his last couple years there, the last 4 years he's there. And in Columbus, I'm sure you remember it. I remember it like it was yesterday when he you know, a request to trade out of Columbus. It was, I mean, it was fucking heartbreaking, dude.
It was, man. I had a, this is going to seem so, I don't know, 10-year-old of me, but, you know, I've been watching this dude forever. I loved him. He was my favorite player on the team.
Me too.
I had a picture of him, on the wall of my apartment. And he, it was either after he had been traded or requested the trade. I don't remember, but I just was sulking and I took it down, and my wife's friend, who ended up being a maid of honor in our wedding, came in into the room and saw it, and she was like, "Oh, you must be so sad." I'm like, yeah.
Yeah, I am. Yeah, 'cause
He was the one really good player on the team, and you know, he gave it all he could, but then he was like, "Sorry, now I'm done.
Yeah,
I've given it all I could, and
it wasn't getting much better for him."
Yeah,
because after that 09 year, they started sliding again and being, you know, what we were used to as Blue Jackets fans. That's for sure.
Oh yeah, I remember. I remember having several conversations with my dad at the time. He'd ask me, "What's going on with the Blue Jackets?" And I said, "God, I swear only the Blue Jackets could have the best season of their existence and then follow it up with the worst. Like, they were terrible."
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, and he's making the All-Star games. He's, you know, wins a Rocket Ricard in there. You know, just a phenomenal player. I mean, when I think of him, I always think of the goal against Arizona.
I mean, how could you not,
dude? It's what, and easily, and I'll say top 10 goals of all time. It was really just, that was how he played. That goal was a perfect, you know, definition of Rick Nash, in my opinion.
Yeah, it was. That was the brilliance, I think, that he was capable of, that he could, I mean, he was one of those special people, one of those rare people who truly could turn a game around by himself. And that was just one instance that he did it. And I actually, I remember when just a month ago or whatever, when he announced his retirement, Mike Commodore, former Blue Jacket teammate, went on Twitter and said, I don't think most people understand how good Rick Nash was, that he could put an entire team on his back and win the game. And that's what he was. Now, he didn't do it all the time.
It's hard to do.
Just to be even capable of it is incredible. And that goal was just pure skill and hard work and wanting it more than the guy next to you, man. And that is still one of my favorite
calls. Those two dudes didn't know what to do. I mean, it was like I bet the goalie watched him go through those guys and went, oh, what the fuck? Like, what do you do there? I mean, it was amazing. And he really did. I mean, any win in those 10 years in Columbus, you have to attribute to Rick Nash.
Oh, yeah. I mean, this was in maybe March of 2008-ish, something like that, when he went into Joe Louis Arena and pretty much beat the Red Wings single-handedly. It was like 8-3. He had a hat trick. And I mean, at that time, people just did not do that to the Red Wings.
Right.
The Red Wings are the ones who did that to everyone else.
Especially not Columbus.
Oh, exactly. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, we're the little brother franchise from day one, where they just routinely would beat us on their ice and our ice just because they could.
Yeah.
You know, beat the stuffing out of us. Yeah, I mean, he was such a huge factor in every one of those wins, like you said.
Now, you know, we talked about when he requested the trade, and I remember being pissed at first and, you know, wanting him to stay and being selfish. And then, you know, before the season had started, it dawned on me, like, what was he going to do? I mean, he realized he was in his prime. Columbus was on a downward trend, and you know, I don't think it was the easiest call for him. I mean, maybe it was easier than I like to think. Maybe I'm kidding myself there, but he did it with class, too. Obviously, you know, requesting the trade sucks, but he also – I remember him taking out that full-page ad in the fuck's the name of the newspaper down there, the Dispatch. And, you know, just really thanking everyone in Columbus and all the fans and the organization and – really had a classy exit out of Columbus.
Yeah, and one thing that maybe a good amount of people forget is that when he requested the trade, he did so on the auspices of it helping the Blue Jackets. He said that, you know, if you guys trade me now, you can get a much better return and all of this and that. And when he said that at the time, I probably reacted like a lot of people. I was like,
yeah, bullshit.
Right, yeah, you're exactly. Yeah. Bull crap. You're not doing this for us, blah, 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 whatever. But as it turns out, Bob McGilligan recently, I think it was when Nash announced his retirement, Bob McGilligan, the radio voice of the Blue Jackets, brought that back up and said that he really did feel that way, that Nash really did feel that he could help the Blue Jackets if he was traded then. And that was a really kind of a nice thing to hear. After all these years of, you know, thinking whatever it is I thought about him.
Yeah.
I
look at it now and go, it was probably the best decision, you know, for him, his family and his career. And it really, I mean, Columbus gets, you know, a guy who's been huge for the program or the organization since that trade happened. I mean, and Brandon Dubinsky, who's been absolutely crucial to the team, you know, was on a tear this year before he got hurt there in the beginning of the season. But, you know, and Artem Anisimov didn't really work out in Columbus, but look at some of the stuff we got for trades for him, you know. And a guy who I really thought was going to pan out and, you know, still might in Toronto, I think he's still in the Toronto organization, was Kirby Reichel, who, you know, was with the Calder. I think he was with the Monsters when they ended up winning a Calder. So he was.
And I can't remember when – or I'm sorry, where, but I think Kirby has been traded maybe two other times. He's on maybe his fourth or fifth.
See, I was thinking that. I think he was, I know, definitely traded once again out of Toronto's at the beginning of the year here, I think. And then maybe, yeah, like you said, again, I think something you know, it's just sometimes it just doesn't pan out, and it's he might have to move around until he gets the right situation, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, you know, what's he's going to break into Toronto's lineup now?
Yeah, no, exactly.
Like, no way, dude, no way.
Exactly. But, I'd like to see him go back out and be with Bednar in Colorado.
Oh yeah, that wouldn't be a terrible fit. They know each other, and
he tore it up, you know, in Bednar his system, knows man. His
skills and.
Yeah, he tore it up with them out there, man. Now, I do not like the New York Rangers at all. And so that was another part of it being like, fuck me. Like, I'm going to have to watch this dude just terrorize us. And they, you know, made the playoffs, what, every year he was there, except for the last one when, you know, he was traded out of there. But, I mean, what else right. could he ask for himself except for the opportunity to be able to win the Stanley Cup? And, you know, They went to the Cup 1 year, didn't they? And was that 14?
They did, yeah. Lost to the Kings.
Lost to the Kings, right. And that was – I mean, they were there for that series, and Nash was a huge part of getting that team there.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, for sure. I want to say that was one of the really concussion-laden years that he had while he was there. But yeah, I mean, he's still –
I think his first year there, he played like half the season because of concussions. That first year in New York,
something like that. He was kind of a ghost, but when he was there, man, he certainly contributed.
And another thing that Nash could do is play a role that a superstar. You know, he could kind of disappear at times and do what he needed to do to win. And that's hard to do as a superstar, but he did it better than anyone, I think.
Yeah, just kind of put the noise on mute and just do his thing. And,
yeah.
And one memory I recall, you know, my dad and I used to go to a lot of games when I was young, and he doesn't know a great deal about hockey or anything like that, but he would see Nash kind of floating in the neutral zone, and he would see him doing it more than once in a game, and he would typically ask, you know, is Nash playing sick or something? He's not really getting in there and that kind of stuff. And I'd explain to him, you know, kind of what he was waiting for, and that was just his way of playing. And I think that kind of goes along with what you're saying of he had his task, and he was focused on it, waiting for that outlet pass, because if he got it, he was going to score.
Yeah, for sure, man. And, you know, another thing I think of, you know, that I liked about him and didn't like as a Columbus fan, but I liked about him you know, when he's in New York, I'm pretty sure the game is in Columbus where he pushes Sergei Bobrovsky after, you know, running into him.
Yes, yeah, give him a little throat punch.
Yeah, and you know, and I like that. He was kind of saying, okay, bye. You know, goodbye. This is I'm a Ranger now. Let's do this shit. And I like that as a fan, you know, him kind of being like, okay, guys, it's the honeymoon's over. I'm here to try to win this cup.
Yeah, I mean, you don't have to, as a Blue Jackets fan, you don't have to like what he did. And there's that, you know, that code or whatever of don't ever touch the goalie, blah. But you got to kind of respect it because he was a Ranger. He wasn't a Blue Jacket. And Sergei started it.
Yeah, exactly. And Nash finished it. And it's so, like you said, you know, goalies can't be touched now, but I mean, tell that to Bob Probert. I mean, it used to be different.
Oh, of course. Yeah, man. It was
and it was
a different game today.
And it was the signification of, you know, it's time to start booing Rick Nash when he comes back to Nationwide. And it's usually 50-50, you know, with Columbus fans. I find out, like, should we boo him? Should we not boo him? I say, fucking boo him all you want. You know, I still boo Carter when he comes there. Like, it's
– yeah,
we should have a little bit of nastiness.
That moment was Nash's turn. He became a heel.
Yeah.
And if – what I hate is when a fan tells another fan
how to be
how
a fan,
to, how to cheer and how to act.
Like, yeah,
if you want to boost somebody, boo them.
Exactly.
I don't care.
You paid
like,
the
you're
ticket.
You're not ruining my day by booing Jeff Carter because I've forgiven him, or I think it's still like boo Carter, boo whoever you want.
Right.
Like, I don't care. I'm not telling you you have to cheer for somebody, so don't tell me that I'm not allowed to boo somebody.
And as an athlete, I would think too, if you're coming back to a place and getting booed, it's almost like at least they're noticing you. Like, I mean that.
Yeah.
You know, it's,
I mean, it kind of means like, oh, I guess I've done something right.
Like
pissing you guys off.
Yeah, Brandon Saad's not getting booed in Nationwide because no one gives a shit.
Yeah. I mean, I would bet that most Blue Jackets fans don't even know what team he plays for anymore.
Yeah, I would say he's probably forgotten in a lot of minds. That's for sure, man.
Yeah.
And Nash has a hell of a time, you know, and is really good in New York and, you know, ends up wearing the A there too. Just really, because I think he's just that. How do you not put a letter on Rick Nash at some point? Because he's just that kind of guy, I think. And whether, I don't know how he is in the room. I've never, you know, been in the room with him, but obviously he's doing something, whether it's the way he plays, why he's getting the letter, or maybe leadership off. And, you know, like you said, he always was doing things in the community outside of hockey as well. And, you know, that last year, you know, him going to Boston was a weird thing. And I always, you know, you had mentioned Bob McElligott, you know, he always was saying that year, you know, on CBJ and 30, it seemed like every fucking episode. And I love Bobby Mack. He's one of the best to do it. You know, I bet money at the end of the year.
Yeah.
Rick Nash.
Yeah, that's his big thing.
Rick Nash will retire in a Blue Jackets jersey. And I was just thinking, like, I didn't like it at the time. And now that he had to retire, I kind of wish he would have been back just to close it. But he might not have wanted to also. And he can't really help the Blue Jackets now.
Yeah, and my whole take on that, and another thing I want to say about McElligott real quick is when he brought up what Nash had said all those years ago, well, I partly wanted to trade to help the Blue Jackets, and, you know, of course, somebody like me is like, yeah, BS, whatever.
Yeah.
And so McElligott brings that back up upon Nash's retirement. But one thing I didn't say earlier that I meant to is that McElligott goes into how Nash was right. Like, he got traded, and we got pieces that helped this team.
Yeah, he was right. Time. Absolutely. Absolutely.
I mean, he was one – love it or hate it, the trade, whatever, the man was right. And that was one thing I really, really liked that McElligott brought up. But anyway,
well, think about like 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon, man. We get Artem Anisimov. We trade him to Chicago for Saad, and we end up trading Saad back to Chicago for a Mr. Artemi Panarin. So, I mean, in a way, we got Artemi Panarin for Rick Nash. I mean, you can break it down to that.
Yeah, and you can always do that. You know, player A for player B gets you player C,
exactly.
And so on and so on down the line. I mean, that's how – unless you're determined to just build through the draft and win a cup that way, and teams do that. It works. You're gonna be trading players and adding pieces. That's
right.
Just the way it goes.
Right.
But back to that McElligott thing about Nash coming back. McElligott brought it up on a recent show and admitted he was wrong. He said, "I really believed that Rick Nash would be back here, and that he." You know, I think he really wanted to be here, and I think he did too. I think he wanted to retire as a Blue Jacket. And I remember hearing, probably before the season started, that he was going to sit the year out until he really was healthy. He wasn't going to come back just to come back and risk getting his brain scrambled.
Yeah.
And it just never worked out for him. His doctors said, "You've got a young family. Don't do it."
Yeah,
and,
high risk.
And so he retired. And I'm with Miguel again. I think that he would have come back, but you're right. This late in the game, is he really going to help the Blue Jackets? Probably not.
No.
Would it have been cool?
It'd been a nice sentiment.
Yeah, it would have been, but I truly believe that he is going to be he's going to get a job in the front office.
I agree.
Hell, he might even end up owning a portion of a team someday, like Mario Lemieux.
Because he still lives in Ohio, doesn't he?
Oh yeah, yep.
I thought so.
He still. I don't know if he lives in the same bachelor pad he did, but yeah, he still lives here.
And you know, he retires and he has a ceremony at Columbus. I'm not sure if he had one in New York. I know he didn't have one in Boston. So it's like he's even announcing his retirement at Columbus too. So it obviously holds a special place in his heart. And you know, he did a lot of his best work in Columbus.
Yeah, and you know, he said during the interview after he had the ceremonial puck drop that Columbus is his home. And you know, granted, you're always going to have the place where you're from, the place where you're born.
Yeah.
And home is just kind of where you hang your hat. But he called this home, and I think he'll just stay here. I think he ends up working for the team, and he's kind of come full circle now, and everybody loves him again. So I think it's a great ending.
Yeah, absolutely. And back to that, you know, cross check to Sergei. I think he ended up fighting Calvert right after that too, and dogging him pretty good. And dogging him pretty good.
He did. Yeah. Calvert got a few good punches to the ear on him, and yeah, it was a good little scrap.
It might be the only fight he ever won, dude. When you're losing to Evgeny Malkin, you're you need to not drop the gloves. That's for sure.
Yeah.
And you don't, dude. You look back, and I'll bring this up. And this is okay. So career numbers, career leaders as the Blue Jackets, and none of this is going to surprise you. I mean, games played, Rick Nash, goals. Rick Nash. And these, and until just recently, you know, with Cam doing as well as he is, these are things that I thought nobody would ever touch. Assists, Rick Nash. Points, Rick Nash. Like even strength goals, Rick Nash. Goals created, Rick Nash. Power play goals, Rick Nash. It's like shorthanded, Rick Nash. Game winning goals, Rick Nash. Shots. It's almost every category. He is the leader.
And the reason you think that stuff like that is never going to be broken is because it's like, all right, when are we going to get another Rick Nash who sticks around for 10 years? Because nobody does that anymore. Like, all right, so great. We've got, you know, the team has Artemi Panarin now who could potentially break all of these records.
Well,
he just
broke his most points in the season, right?
Right, just broke it last year.
Right.
But who's going to stick around?
Right.
You know, unless you're, I don't know, unless you're a Steven Stamkos and your team is right on the doorstep every year, you're probably not sticking around for 10, 12 years.
Yeah. It doesn't happen very often. And, you know, I think, you know, one, Martin St. Louis signing and helping out and maybe being a guy who's going to stick around the organization. I think that's going to help, you know, keep some of the guys around a little longer, but the name of the game isn't be in a place for 10 years. It's play somewhere for 3 years and then get paid and then see what happens after that.
Yeah. Yeah. It's, you know, get past your ELC mm-hmm. and, you know, play as well as you can, get a big fat contract, get traded and then try to win a cup.
Yep.
You know, that's just kind of the way it goes. The name of the game, as you said.
Now, he, you know, has a Stanley Cup appearance. He was on a few of the gold medal winning teams, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
And really just had a phenomenal career. And the big talk now is, does he get his number put in the rafters in Columbus? And I'll give you my opinion and see what you think about it. And, you know, it's not an easy decision because I really take that honor Seriously, as a fan, I don't like to just see shit up in the rafters just to have it up there.
Just for the sake of having it.
Right, and I think if you really need one, it obviously, sure, put them up there. But I don't think that he is a rafter number for me. I really don't think I would raise it up there and put it up there. And I thought a lot about it, and it's really close because he was so good, but then it didn't really matter like how good he was. And, you know, look at Dan Marino. Nobody's going to know who the fuck he was now because his numbers are erasing. Eventually Rick Nash's numbers are going to be erased, and I just don't see the need to rush a number up there. Your thoughts, Mr. Shane Guilfoyle?
I'm with you on the don't retire a number for the sake of retiring it. Don't rush it. Eventually he will be forgotten, but that's a lot.
But he made Columbus hockey too. So it's like,
Rick Nash being forgotten in Columbus is going to be a long time down the road. Like I said, he's going to end up working for this organization. He might even own part of it someday.
Yeah, you got me there. That's true. I mean,
whether they retired or not, I don't know that I care one way or the other.
Good point, too.
But to answer the question, will they? I think they will.
I think they will.
Because for 10 years, he was Columbus hockey.
Right.
And, you know, love him or hate him for leaving the way that he did. Man.
You know what I think would be cooler is if you ever went to the Joe and, you know, Little Caesars now, they have those really badass bronze statues of Ted Lindsay and Gordie Howe. I would like to see something like that, maybe before the stairs at the back entrance of Nationwide. You know, maybe him scoring that goal against Arizona or, you know, something like that. I think that is something that will be witnessed more because, I mean, some people don't even look up in the rafters, especially in Columbus. There's nothing to see, but I think that I think that would be more fitting. And like you said, I think they will. And am I going to care? No, I'm going to be happy for him, and it's going to be nice. And he does, you know – you've changed my mind. He does deserve it because the city wouldn't even have taken the time to bail that team out and let them continue to be a team if Rick Nash wasn't a part of that team.
Yeah, I think you're right. He meant so much to
dude. I'm tearing up talking about him, dude.
The kids and I remember this one thing. Right around the 10-year anniversary, I was watching this video. He was a guy who went to schools and went to hospitals, Nationwide Children's, and that sort of thing. And he never took any cameras. You know, it wasn't like, okay, Rick Nash is on the town. Let's follow Rick and see what awesome. Like, he just went.
Just a good guy.
The dude just went, and he just talked to kids. And I remember seeing this one thing. Now, this one actually happened to be filmed, I think because it was at a school. And he was – I think he had just been in a fight, and he had a big shiner on his face.
It's probably when he went with Vandermeer.
What's that?
It said it's probably when he dropped with Vandermeer.
Maybe. Could have been.
Because he got bloodied up in that one.
Yeah, he got tuned up. And so some kid asks him what it's like to be punched in the face. And he just kind of laughs and he tells him, oh, it hurts. You know, it's part of the game. I'm sticking up for a teammate. And then goes on to tell him how it's that kind of thing is saved for the ice, and you don't just walk around bullying people and hitting people in the face and that kind of thing. Like, it was just a really
wise words,
just like a real I'm using my wife's words here because she's a teacher, but it was just like a real teaching moment, you know? Like, I mean, this kid was probably 8 years old, you know? And I just thought it was a really neat thing for him to realize that the kid probably thought the scar on his face or the bruise on his face was cool. And instead of being like, yeah, man, let's get out there and F people up, you know, he took the time to say, fighting is a part of the game. It's necessary. I did what I had to do. But when you're walking on the street, you don't do that to people. And so I thought that was I thought that was really cool. And he means so much to the team and the city that that I think that eventually the team does retire his number. And actually, I'm glad that that I didn't forget this. You brought up the bronze statue thing. You know who deserves a bronze statue? And I have tried for about the last at least 6 years to get this thing built. John H. McConnell needs a bronze statue.
He sure does. He sure does.
He is the reason this team is here, and he's the reason this team is still here.
I wonder why he doesn't have one.
You know, he's got a banner in the rafters. It's a memorial banner that says, "Thank you, Mr. Mac."
And he's got the glass case thing out there too, like telling who he is or whatever. I think it's like a Jersey history or some shit like that.
Little Hall of Fame glass thing.
Yeah.
But man, if. I'd be fine with Nash getting a statue, but boy, does Mr. Mac need a statue.
Well, let's do a Mac statue, and let's put Nash in the fucking boards, and let's start winning some goddamn playoff games.
That would be – all of that would be fantastic.
Also, you know that kid grew up to be Jared Bull.
It took me a minute to catch on there. yeah, exactly.
Well, you've changed my mind. I really, you know, I think they should put him up there now. And I know there was a piece on All Beard No Teeth that came out about, you know, Rick Nash and, you know, hashtag hero or some shit like that. I haven't been able to take time and read it yet, but I encourage everybody to go on allbeardnoteeth.com and read that article. I'm going to do the same thing tonight, and I'm sure Shane will as well. I know he's
constantly reading, constantly
learning. And
never actually talked to him, but I love those guys.
Oh, he's terrible to talk to. You can't understand a word he's saying. just messing with you, Beard. I love you, buddy. Griffin's the best. Now, I appreciate you coming on, man. I think we really covered Rick Nash pretty well. I'm satisfied, and I like that you changed my mind about the Raptors. I say let's get that shit up there, and you know, and it was a perfect opportunity to have you on here too, you know, because you have one of my favorite hockey podcasts, the history of hockey, and covering his career like that, it is history, and Rick Nash is always going to be a part of Columbus hockey history, period.
Yeah, and I do plan sometime in the future doing team specific historical episodes, and nice. You know, so when covering the Blue Jackets, he'll be a really big part of it. That's for sure.
Absolutely. And you know, tell the Biscuit Babies where they can find you. I know I'm sure most of the listeners listen to your show, but you know, just remind some of the guys that you know, that might be new people that haven't heard of the History Hockey Podcast. I misspoke and said favorite hockey podcast. It's literally one of my favorite podcasts. I don't miss an episode, man.
Oh, man, I really appreciate that. Thank you for the kind words. Biscuit Babies can find the show on friggin' everything, I suppose. iTunes, Spotify, you name it, it's on there. But it's the History of Hockey Podcast. It's got a scary goalie mask as the cover art. On Twitter, it's the HOH pod. And get a hold of me there if you want to talk. I've recently started doing some couple interview episodes, which have been surprisingly fun. I see why you do so many of them.
Absolutely.
Got a new episode of the podcast coming out today.
Hell yeah.
And, so that'll be ready for everybody's ears tomorrow. And, working on some dark, dark stuff for the coming months.
Good, as you know. Yeah, I'm really excited about what we talked about the other day. I actually told you to stop telling me about it because I can't wait to hear it. Fascinating episodes coming your way for anybody checking out the History of Hockey podcast. Absolutely bone chilling, to be honest. And
About halfway. It's going to be a two-parter. I'm about halfway through the first one, man. And
dude,
it's,
I can't wait.
Dude, it's already making me sick. So.
Oh God, dude, it's it's going to be an interesting one. That's for sure, man. And you're on Instagram at HOHpod2, I believe.
Yep.
And
you have Instagram, Twitter.
And you still have the Patreon up?
Yep. Okay. Yep. Patreon at the History of Hockey Podcast. I got to renew my website, thehistoryofhockeypodcast.com. I've got to do that in the next few days because that's expiring. Yeah.
Hell yeah.
Email thehohpod@gmail.com if you want to get a hold of me the old-fashioned way. But the best choice is to just listen to the damn show.
Hell yeah, man. And go donate. Don't be a bitch. Shane,
yeah, I would definitely appreciate that. Everything goes to research materials and reading my tail off. So
right back into the show the way it should be.
Absolutely. Yep. Yep. It's all you guys donate and it gets recycled. So,
Shane, you are the best, man. I really appreciate your time.
Absolutely. Anytime.
I hope you have a good day, man. Thanks for doing this.
Yep. You too, brother.
Have a good one. Yep. Have a good one, man.